Good evening. Hello, everybody. I'm Elaine Bedell. I'm the Chief Executive of South Bank Centre, and it is my great pleasure to welcome you here this evening and to welcome everybody who is joining us on our live stream around the world. This wonderful concert hall was, of course, built in 1951 as part of the Festival of Britain, an initiative to rebuild a country after a traumatic crisis with a celebration of music, art, poetry, innovation, and ideas. And that idea, the power of art to make us all feel better, to restore a nation's health and well-being, runs through everything that we do at South Bank. And who better embodies that than Sir Paul McCartney? We also believe at South Bank Centre that access to that art and culture should be free and available to everybody, no matter what their background or privilege. And that's why... And that's why we open our doors at 10 o'clock in the morning and anybody can come in and use the wonderful civic spaces that are part of this building. But of course, for 20 dark months, we weren't able to open the doors and we were closed. It has been a long road to reopening. You might say a long and winding road. I promise I'm not going to do any more of those. But with thanks to a loan from the Cultural Recovery Fund, with thanks to continuing support from the Arts Council, we are now fully open. And I can't tell you how glad we are to see you all here. We are nothing without our audiences. So thank you so much for coming back to us. Thank you for supporting us. Thank you for staying with us. We're very honoured to be co-hosting this world-exclusive event with Penguin Live, a celebration of the publication of the lyrics from 1956 to the present, an extraordinary catalogue of every song that Paul McCartney has ever written, from his earliest boyhood compositions through to the decade of the Beatles, Wings, and to his solo career. It's also full of material from his personal archive, including photographs and original text of his writing. And in each case, it describes the circumstances under which he wrote the song and the inspiration for it. His collaborator on the book is the poet Paul Muldoon, and he'll be joining Sir Paul McCartney on stage. Paul Muldoon, of course, a renowned poet. He's published 14 volumes of his own collected poetry, including his latest, Howdy Skelp. Tonight's event's going to be chaired by the broadcaster and writer Samira Ahmed. It's going to begin with a short film, and then our guests will join us on stage. Thank you all for submitting your questions in advance. We've had an awful lot of questions. Samira is going to do her best to ask them on your behalf towards the end of the event. Tonight's event is part of the South Bank Centre London Literature Festival, which has been taking place over the last few weeks. And I'm very glad to say we've had exclusive appearances from writers like Sally Rooney, Bernardine Evaristo, Vole Sayinka, and Ai Weiwei. And because tonight is a celebration of poetry and lyricism, I can't resist mentioning that we are also home to the National Poetry Library, which is in this building on the fifth floor. Please do visit us if you haven't done already. And also to mention that we have a new project, the New Poets Collective, the Young Poets Collective, a new project to nurture 14 young poetic talents who I hope will be the Paul Muldoons and the Paul McCartneys of tomorrow. I want to thank Penguin Live, who are brilliant partners, for co-hosting this event with us. I want to thank Dice, who are doing our live stream, and I want to thank the South Bank Literature team, headed by the brilliant Ted Hodgkinson, and our senior producer tonight, Kathy Astley. I also want to thank Claire Hill, who is furiously typing as we speak, who's converting the speech to text in order to make this event accessible. And we have BSL interpretation on stage from Paul Michaels. From Paul Michaels and Paul Mancini. So why have two Pauls on stage when we can have four? Thank you. We've had Igor Stravinsky on this stage. We've had Maria Callas. We've had Frank Sinatra, Nina Simone, Dizzy Gillespie. We've had David Bowie. We've had Pink Floyd. We've had Elton John. We've had Adele. We've had Paul Weller. But we have never before had Paul McCartney on this stage. And I am so glad that we're rectifying that tonight. I hope you have a magical evening. Thank you so much for coming, and thank you for your continued support.
Thank you.
I love you too.
So, welcome everyone here at the Royal Festival and everyone watching from around the world on the live stream to this very special evening about the lyrics, Paul McCartney in conversation with Paul Muldoon and all of us. What would the teenage Paul McCartney think of talking about his song lyrics in the Royal Festival room?
Well, he wouldn't believe it. What would I think? There's no way I would think that kind of thing at that age. But if someone said, you know, many years from now you will be at the Royal Festival Hall, I would have been gobsmacked. I only ever saw the Royal Festival Hall when it was things like coronations and stuff, you know, it was sort of stuff that came from London to us on the telly. Other than that, I had no experience of it. So yeah, I would have been totally gobsmacked.
A very practical question about the book, which is wonderful, is the songs are all organized alphabetically, which I thought was unexpectedly fun. So you could put on an LP and then look up the songs as they come up. How do you hope people will read the lyrics?
I think, how did we come up with that, Paul?
Well, that was something I came up with, actually. Because thank you. And of course, everyone signed on. Everyone at the great publishing houses involved here were happy with that. And the rationale for me was that it would be even more of an adventure as one came round a corner, you know? And what comes next. And though there was some sense that there would be an autobiographical aspect to the book, it was quite far back. And had we been setting out to do that, I think we would have done it chronologically. In this case, I think one of the effects it has is that there's a sense of a great continuum right the way through Paul McCartney's career. And so one is delighted, you know, from something from his teenage years, from his Beatles years, and from more recently. And it has that effect.
And there are only 154. How did you choose them? Was there a culling process?
Well, you know, I mean, the truth about this was that it was put to me that we could do a book about my lyrics. And I sort of said, yeah, that sounds like a good idea. I didn't really do an awful lot more until Paul and I met up. And the idea then was that we would just talk to each other. And Paul would say to me, well, wait, what about this? Or what about that line? What did you think? And working with him as a poet, it was interesting for me because we were really analyzing the lyrics and where did it come from and stuff. And I think more things came out that way. But really, my contribution was just to talk for 5 years to this man.
Which is quite an achievement.
It was quite an achievement.
Well, I was wondering where you started your conversations. So there used to be a radio show called In the Psychiatrist's Chair, where a guest revealed their thoughts in conversation. And I know, as this was done over years, what buried memories and surprises emerged during your time in the poet's chair?
I don't know. I think just going over the songs, a good thing that happened was it wasn't just all to do with the songs. We'd be talking about the lyrics and then something would spin off. So I would suddenly think about my hitchhiking holidays with John and George separately. And I'd tell Paul this, you know, so I'd sort of then say, well, you know, and I tell you what it struck me was that it wouldn't be John or George that would say to me, should we go hitchhiking? It would be me that would say to them, you want to go hitchhiking? And so those kind of things were brought up just during the talking about the lyrics. But I suppose I'd vote for hitchhiking.
Hitchhiking was a major topic, but I think even in that regard, a ticket to ride, you know, we came to a realization that there's a pun in there, as I'm sure many of you are aficionados will know about that, but it was wonderful to be able to get under the skin of the lyrics. And by the way, the book is called The Lyrics. It's not called The Songs. So we were really focusing on just what you describe. Mm. Getting into the texts, and actually in the tradition of a man who was extremely important to Paul McCartney, Alan Durband, who's his high school teacher, and who had studied under F.R. Leavis at Cambridge, and who was himself very interested in close reading. And that's basically what we were attempting to do on each occasion that we met. And of course, we met for usually 2 or 3 hours, let's say. And we were determined, if I may say, to come out of that room with something fresh. I mean, we pinched ourselves on almost every occasion.
Well, you pinched me.
Well, but I'd already pinched myself just to make sure that I was there. But that was part of what we were trying to do, I think. And I think we've achieved it, and any of you who've had the chance to look at or through the book so far will realize that there is a lot of new material here, which, you know, is one of the beauties of the book.
Yeah. Well, one of the joys of the book is there are all these objects from your archives, including all these old notebooks, including school notebooks that you wrote lyrics in, and I was fascinated by what turned up when you went through them. Were there visual things that you suddenly saw and it took you back?
Yeah, you know, the nice thing about looking at the words, what you could call a manuscript, but that's a bit elevated, you know, I'd call it the words on a scrap of paper, but was that you cross it out and you change a lyric. It was always nice for me to see, oh, I was going to say that, but crossed out, and it became this hopefully better word that was used. So I like that, you know, just looking through all of those bits and pieces. But I must say, you know, once this idea of having old lyric sheets and photographs and bits of drawings and memorabilia came about, the kids, I call them, they're great big grown-ups, really, but the kids in my office really got hold of the whole project, and we have an archives department, and they have stuff I didn't know I had. So it's fascinating. I mean, one of the things we were talking about, it came up in the conversation, was I was saying to Paul, I remember years and years ago that John and I, before we were in the Beatles, we were just hanging out at my house, and we decided we'd write a play. And so I'd talked about this with people for millions of years and said, yeah, we once tried to write a play. And I was going through the lyrics and stuff in my archive department, and the guys were showing me this, oh, what about that? Oh, that's great, and we use that. And then they said, we don't know what this is. And there was just this pencil thing. I said, bloody hell, that's the play. And, you know, God, I mean, talk about coming through the years. It was incredible. And it was this little play that John and I had tried to write, but given up after about four pages.
Yeah, though you can read the extract in it, and there's even a kitchen sink in that play, isn't there, in the kitchen.
Yeah. It was from the kitchen sink era.
But I think it's also an indicator of the extent to which so many of the songs, right the way through, are dramas or mini-dramas. And the tradition of the stage, of course, and you had the opportunity when you were first in London to go to so many theatrical productions, had a huge impact. And this is not to speak, of course, of radio drama. And so, you know, the capacity that you have to present a character in a song is absolutely vital, I think. It's one of the components. There are a number of others. But it's one of the components that makes these songs so effective, is your sense of the songs having a dramatis personae. There's a list of characters. Yeah, there may just be two, but that's all you need to get a play going. One character, you've got a poem. Two characters, you've got a play.
Okay. I want to ask you about your English teacher, Mr. Durbin, now, because I want to then bring it into other things. He was a big influence on you, and Paul Muldoon mentioned that, you know, he'd studied under F.R. Leavis, so the whole way he kind of got you looking at literature was important. Can you tell me a bit about some of the stuff that you think he taught you in terms of how to write and how to think about writing?
So his name was Alan Durbin, and he was just the teacher that I ended up with. So I didn't choose him or anything, but he was great. And his subject was English literature. Now, we were kind of, by then, I was like about a 16-year-old Liverpool guy. Not very interested in literature, tell you the truth. It was like, yeah, all right, you know, great. But he saw that. So he had to teach us so we'd pass an exam or two. And he brought up Chaucer. We were doing Chaucer and Canterbury Tales. But we were doing like the Nun's Tale or something. And he would say these passages in Chaucerian English. And we would go, hey, sir, sorry, but you kidding? You know, like... Here, Wimpel Pincher was. We go, whoa, what's that? You know. Anyway, he introduced us to a great book by Neville Coghill, which had the translation opposite on the page. So you could read the Chaucer and then just go right across and get what it meant in modern day English. And Alan was very clever because he took me aside and he said, you should read The Miller's Tale. And I didn't know what he meant. I said, okay, so I did, read it. And it's filthy. Which appealed to me as a 16-year-old Liverpool boy.
Excellent.
So that was the thing. And then I got really interested. And so anything we did, anything he suggested, I was now hooked.
And the other big influence we have to talk about is your family background and the role of music and your parents. Tell me about that.
Yeah, well, I was very lucky. I came from a really good family. I thought, at the time, I thought everyone has a good family. Everyone I thought was growing up like me. But as I grew older, I realized that loads of people have quite horrible families or terrible times, you know. Anyway, so I was very lucky. And the big highlight was the New Year's Eve do's in Liverpool. So my dad was the pianist for that. There's always like one person who's good on the piano, and that was my dad. So it would be great. All the family would gather together, all the uncles and aunts and cousins and kids and everybody. It was a great big celebration. And my dad would sit down at the piano and play these old songs. Well, they're now old. I don't think they were that old then. And all the aunties knew them. That's another long story as to why they knew them. But they all knew them, and so they all sang them. So for us kids, it was just great hearing him play and them, oh, the red robin goes bop, bop, bop. It was great, you know, so it really drew me into the musical thing. And then he would play at home, so I would listen to the chords and listen to the stuff. And then, as Paul said, listen to the radio. So it all kind of tied in. So by the time I came to think about writing songs, I had quite a lot of music in me by then from these sources.
Was there, I had to be jingoistic about this, but I'm going to go ahead.
You're going to say bardic tradition.
Well, I was going to ask about the extent to which there was a sense of Ireland lurking about in the background. I mean, there was some sense of it, perhaps?
Yeah, a little bit. But when we talked, I was always trying to give you a bit more Irish.
I'm sorry about that. I did my best.
You know, I love that, because when we'd be talking, Paul would sort of say, you know, I'd say, she was just 17, da, 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 beyond compare, and he'd say, oh, beyond compare. Is that to do with the ballad? She books the beyond compare. And I'd be going, well, yeah, kind of. Meaning, no. But it was great, you know, because I think some of them were. There was some Irish, definitely. I mean, my whole family was originally from Ireland, so there's stuff there. But I was hoping there was a bit more to throw you some bones of Irish stuff.
We can work on that. Well, having mentioned I saw her standing there, I was allowed to pick two clips out of Paul McCartney's entire career to give us a taste of. And I wonder if you can guess what I picked for the first one. Let's have a listen. Hearing that on the Royal Festival Hall stage is something,
yeah,
isn't it?
Great.
So there are a couple of things I wanted to draw out of that, and there's lovely images which are all in the book. One is, where are you performing with the rosy cheeks? Is that a wedding?
Yeah, that was at my Auntie Jean's house. And yeah, we would occasionally show up there. I think that was a wedding. And because we had guitars, we were like keen to practice and also to show off. So so we would go there and we'd just get in a corner and just sing all our songs. You know, and the people at the party would enjoy it. The guy on the right there, the guy standing with his beer, you know, he used to come up and sort of stand close to us and kind of like be part of us. almost. But that was Dennis. Yeah, you know, it was fabulous. I mean, I love that photo because we're just such fresh-faced little boys.
But also, you've said that you think that song is one of your best.
You know, it's always difficult to choose what's your best song kind of thing. But, I mean, I think that's very... it's nice because it's got a lot of good memories. I can remember being in what you call the front parlour.
Which is that photo of you and John. You're there.
Yeah,
in that photo.
With me, that was the photo of me and John. And just playing it to John for the first time, you know, because when we got together, he was the first person ever that when I'd said, oh, yeah, I've written a couple of songs, he said, so have I. Everybody else was never interested. They go, yeah, I've written about, yeah, what do you think of the football? You know, I go, songs? No. But John said, yeah, so we got together, and I played him that. And the first collaborative moment, really, was that I started off, she was just 17. She'd never been a beauty queen. And I kind of looked at him like, what do you think of that? And he kind of looked at me like... So it was like, okay, we're going to find another line. We can't have beauty queens. So we said, you know what I mean? And I think it works much better. But straight away,
don't you think? You could imagine parents hearing that line.
Yeah, do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
I know, it's funny, we were at an event and the American comedian Jerry Seinfeld was there and he was doing a little speech. And he said, Paul, you know, your song, I saw her standing there. He said, the lyrics, she was just 17, you know what I mean. Paul, I'm not sure we do know what you mean.
And can I also ask, one of the beautiful things that photo captures is because you were left-handed, the way you and John sat like a mirror image of each other. Can you tell me a bit about working with John and writing together?
Yeah, that was one of the great little lucky things that we never thought about. But as you say, when we sat down like that, our guitars didn't knock into each other. And it was the same on stage, that if me and George were at a microphone, his guitar went that way, mine went this way. So you see other people, and they've got to kind of try and manage it so they don't bang their guitars. So yeah, that was the sort of first nice thing. And then I realized that as we were making up songs, and I'd suggest a line, and he'd suggest a line, that was very much how we did it, you know, just ping-ponging off each other. That because he was right-handed, for me it was like looking in a mirror. So it was great, I could kind of see the chords I was playing in the mirror, because, you know, so that kind of just, it made it a little bit more exciting.
And you do talk a lot about John in the book, you know, and reflect on all the different stages of your time together. And I wonder how it was thinking about working with him and remembering both the early days and the later periods.
Oh, it was great. I mean, you know, it was always great to work with John from the very first thing where I said, you know, he said, yeah, I write songs too. And we just developed a way of working with each other and trusting each other that grew and grew. You know, and once I wanted to go into, I don't know, maybe something more like Eleanor Rigby or something, he'd go into something like that. You know, we grew up together. It was like sort of walking up a staircase and we both went side by side up that staircase. So it was very exciting. And now that the Beatles, recording career is kind of finished. I'm like a fan. I just remember how great it was to work with him and how great he was. Because you know, you're not messing around here. You know, you're just not just singing with Joe Bloggs. You're singing with John Lennon. Give it up.
I I think one of the wonderful things that comes out of this book is your love for him. And it's very moving. And, you know, some of those last meetings that you had with him where, you know, had there been some little wobble, let's call it, in previous years, there was a great sense of your somehow having, I mean, this rapprochement, something that you were actually somewhat back in there again. Would that be fair?
Yeah, it's true. And you say that I loved him. You know, as 16-year-old, 17-year-old, Liverpool kids, you could never say that. It just wasn't done. So I never did. I never really just said, John, love you, man. You know, it's never got around to it. So now it is great to just realize, yeah, how much I love this man.
And there are songs like Here Today where you do talk a lot about your relationship. There was one moment I just wanted to bring up because I was watching some old ITN Pathé news archive, and it was when you were touring America after that Jesus comment of John's had been picked up and the Ku Klux Klan were leading people and burning records. And you both walk out in the middle of this tour, and a journalist is saying, you know, it's still going on, and you can tell John looks a little nervous, and you go, oh, no, it's all going to be fine. I don't know if you can remember that moment, but it seemed there was something very protective about you at that moment. And as a band, you all seemed very protective of each other when one was vulnerable. Is that how it was?
Mm. Yeah, I mean, it was the four of us against the world. You know, we were going into all these strange situations, and we had each other to deal with all these situations. So, yeah, that was a terrible thing, because John had just done rather a good little article with Maureen Cleave of the Evening Standard, and it was quite thoughtful. Yeah. But in the middle of it all, he's talking about religion, he's talking about churches, and the congregations had been dwindling, and we kind of felt a little bit sorry for them because our congregation was not dwindling. Ours was going the other way. So I think that's what he was saying, you know, that he was, in a way, trying to give a clue to the churches that, you know, you just got to do something that people like a bit more, you know.
Well, it was around that time that so many churches actually picked up the guitar.
Yeah.
In an attempt to get a few more people back.
And it kind of worked.
And it kind of worked.
It worked, you know. So that's what he was talking about. And he happened to say, you know, we're more popular than Jesus. But when you pick that out, that's like, oh, you know. And so particularly down in the southern states in America, where you've got a lot of evangelists and things, I remember my most clear image is being on the tour bus. And you see the crowds outside, we're all waving and being inside. And there was this one little blonde kid. He couldn't have been more than 14 years old. And he's banging on the window. Yeah, going, all right, mate. But he was incensed about something.
And can I just ask, because in the book there is, you know, you do in different stages talk about a lot of things very frankly. Was it hard deciding how frank to be in writing the lyrics about some of, you know, the downsides with the band?
Yeah, I think so. You know, it's you want to just tell the truth, but you've got to be guarded to some extent. You know, all the people who come out with the truth normally get knocked down. So you'd have to... I remember when we first went to America, they said, don't talk about the Vietnam War, whatever you do. So the first thing we did was, well, what about the Vietnam War? So, you know, you just had to try and gauge how honest you could be. We wanted to be really honest because we knew that our fans were kind of like us. But we had to guard it to some extent.
So vis-a-vis this book, I would say that had it been, absolutely, determinedly an autobiography, then I think there would probably, have been many more occasions on which the notion of, let's have a tell-all here would have been might have been appropriate. But I don't think that's what we were involved with. And certainly there were moments when there would be a reference to someone that perhaps, one would rethink. And people who are still alive, not that you were saying anything dreadful about anyone, but one has to be very mindful of, people's feelings. Having said that, I don't think there was anything on which I had the sense anyway that you were holding your punches or whatever the term is, So I think it is very direct, I'd say, but not in a way that's going to be offensive to anyone. Mm.
Although I was listening to Radio 4 last night and one of your episodes of Inside the Songs, and they had to get special permission from the head of Radio 4 for you to use rude words twice at 7:15.
To use the word what?
I'm not going to say what the word is.
Oh, I'm sorry.
You can all go and look it up. I want to play another clip now, because I think it will enable us to talk a bit more about your songwriting. And this is from the 2013 album New. Let's have a listen. So, 2 things. Is that first photo is a passport photo of yours, isn't it?
Yes, I must say, I haven't seen that for years. But
I think there's even a spot on your face. I didn't know you ever had spots. It was amazing.
Oh, I had spots, believe me. But you know what I noticed about that photo? I'm not looking at the camera. Because in those days, you were allowed to just kind of try and look groovy. But nowadays, you've got to look right at the camera and not smile. Because it is totalitarian state.
Well, no, you look very dreamy in that photo. And
dreamy, yeah, that's me.
And this is my favorite question for you. I want to talk to you about buses. And that song starts with riding the big green bus to work. And they loom large in your legend, Sir Paul, buses, don't they?
Yeah. I never realized it, but then I'd tell stories to Paul, or more recently to my eldest grandson. And he was doing an essay for his final thesis at university, and he wanted to look into the Cultural Revolution in Britain. So we sat down, and I was talking to him, and he was about Liverpool. What?
Is he here?
He is here. Yeah. So we started talking, and every story I told him, I met George on a bus. I first saw John on a bus. George auditioned on a bus. We went across town to find this guy who knew B7 on a bus.
Penny Lane
was the bus depot.
The bus depot.
So, yeah, so there were millions of stories about bus. And then he very cleverly, I thought, looked up why the bus system was so good. And after the war, World War II, there had been the Transport Act. So he researched it and found, I can't remember, it was like Herbert Morrison, did the Transport Act. So that gave us this great bus system. So in Liverpool, you could go anywhere. If I was visiting John, I could go from my place in Fortland Road to Penny Lane, change, and go up to his place in Menlo Avenue. School and all of this. There was this amazing system that I didn't realize. We were kind of the first generation to benefit from that. And also there was an education act that meant that kids like me from not very well-off homes could go to very posh schools. And I think that the idea that he puts forward in his essay is that this gave everyone over Britain this opportunity to be more mobile and more educated, and that was a big factor in the Cultural Revolution.
I want to come back to that. Well, I know I sound obsessed with buses, but I had one more question about the buses first, which is being on the upper deck and the view and how important that was, and the length of your commute to school, because it was half an hour, that all seemed quite relevant. And also, there's an interview you did on one of the kind of Pop Goes the Beatles type shows that was on the Live at the BBC album, where you're asked about what you miss now that you're famous, and you're straight in with, like, riding on a bus. And it really mattered to you, losing that. Is it thinking time? Is it dreaming time? Is it the view?
Yeah. I just like buses.
Thing. And what about the per train? Because as the bus was coming into its own, the train was being demoted, as it were, by Dr. Beeching,
and
if you remember
Beeching.
Him.
Yeah, that was later, yeah.
Apple, wasn't he, to take a look at taking
a little later.
But I like trains, too.
You do like trains.
But, no, the bus was great because it creeps in everything, everywhere, as you said, you know, in the day in the life. Woke up, caught the bus, and, you know, that was me just, it's true, you know, just running up the road, thinking I'm late, getting at the bus stop. But then when you got on the bus, you had this half hour to just look around, and I really enjoyed just observing Liverpool, the people. So even when I go up there now, I drive whoever I'm with. Latest occasion was with my grandkids. And I've got a tour. It's like, you know, I should do it professionally.
You do go back a lot. What draws you back to Liverpool so much?
Well, because I love it, really. Yeah, hey, up the pool. And the other thing is my old school, which was where I went with George, was called the Liverpool Institute High School for Boys. It's now the Liverpool Institute for Performing Arts. And
thanks to
and
you.
That, yeah, yeah, let's hear it. But that's, you know, that's a great place. And I go up there and talk to the songwriters in the year. And so that's a great thing. And for the graduation, you know, it's nice to have a reason like that to go up pretty much every year, except for COVID, we missed one. But bottom line is I love it. And I've got so many memories there.
Yeah. And opposite, you know, the kind of quarry with the graveyard around the cathedral? I remember walking around it, and I met an architect who said that walk from the Catholic Cathedral along Hope Street, past the Philharmonic, past the Liverpool Institute to the Anglican Cathedral is the greatest street in the country. And I think he's right. And then you go down into that park and it's full of gravestones of like sea captains and emigrants who drowned on the way. Mm. You used to spend time there with John, didn't you? You used to hang out there. I think you used to bunk off school, possibly.
I mean, yeah, that whole street, it is great. What's on it, as you said, all of those kind of special places. But main memory is in the cemetery that surrounds this largest cathedral in Europe, I think. Yeah. The cemetery there was where we used to bunk over and sunbathe. So that was, you know, if ever you had like a little free time from school, or even if you didn't.
Stay in school, kids.
We would get over in there, so. So, you know, like I say, I've got so many memories. And any little thing like that triggers off another memory. So just thinking that then triggers off the little shop on the corner that was our tuck shop and where you could go and buy loose cigarettes. They're called Lucy's. And you get a little cigarette for tuppence. So, you know, I mean, there's so many little things that I come flooding back when I think about this, that I think that's why I love it.
Do you still dream about Liverpool?
Yeah, I dream about everything. You know, Liverpool, yeah, I do, actually. Yeah, there's, you know, in your dreams, I don't know if it happens to everyone, because I don't really talk to everyone about how they dream. But yeah, for me, there's places that I'm at, and I know that house over there is where I'm trying to get to, and I never can. It's like, you know, excuse me, do you know the way? Is that Wavertree over there? And I don't know. Yeah, but answer your question, yes, I do.
Excellent. I've just lost all thought for a second just listening to you. Let me have a think and start surprising.
Were there any songs that derived directly from a dream? Well, of course, maybe you dreamed at least one tune.
I dreamed a bunch, yes. That was a good lead-in.
There you go. Thank you, Paul Muldoon.
Yeah. Let It Be was a dream. Yeah.
But also, I didn't realise, and I did Hamlet for A-level as well, I didn't realise that Let It Be is a line from Hamlet.
No, I didn't realise that either.
Is it him?
Well, what I'd say about that is that your unconscious knew about it. And since so much of this derives from the unconscious, you know, that there are... I think one of the aspects of being an artist is that one does not necessarily always know where things come from. In fact,
really?
I think... You know, at its best, I think, you know, one's art comes from somewhere where one knows absolutely nothing about, which I think is an idea that you would share.
No, that's something we talked about, because it's the same for you in poetry.
Yes.
That you don't really know where it's coming from. Do you remember the line? What is it? It's the end of a scene.
And well, the Hamlet line. It's from when when Hamlet's dying, he says to Horatio... let it be, Horatio. I don't remember the rest of the line.
Yeah.
Well, there's also, I mean, it's a word that that's a song with a lot of religious iconography, imagery in it, of course, Mother Mary. And let it be is a translation in some sense of the word amen, so be it, let it be. Oh, yeah. So I think it's going on at that level too. So... Yeah, I think that's happening there.
Even better.
That's true. You know, it was just a very special thing, you know, because I'd lost my mum probably about 10 years before, tragically, to breast cancer. And nobody talked about it. You didn't know what it was. You just knew she died. And it was like you just left to deal with it and you didn't talk to anyone. Those days, you didn't have therapists or anything. You just kind of got on with it. So it was that, you know, 10 years later, when I saw her in the dream, this is the great thing about dreams for me, is that it brings back someone, and it's as if they're really there, because it's just in your head, I know, but at the time, you don't know that. So it was so fabulous just being in a room with my mom. It was like, oh my gosh. And you just get that beautiful, peaceful feeling over you thinking, oh, you're alive. I can't believe it, you know. And just talking to her, and she was just so sort of, I don't know, saintly. You know, she was a nurse, she was a midwife, so she had a lot of that kind of quality. And just saying to me, it's going to be okay. It's going to be all right. She could tell I was worried about something. She said, it's going to be okay. Just let it be. And so it was very warming to have that dream. And, you know, I felt great when I awoke from it and then thought, that's a great title.
It is. Yeah. Absolutely. We've talked about some individual inspirations, but you know, one of the famous things behind the sort of Beatles story and your story is that, of course, you really knew your sort of rock and roll songwriters as well as knowing kind of the whole sort of sing-along tradition that your family had. And I just wondered if you could tell us a bit about the American rock and roll songwriters and performers who really influenced you as a teenager in the band. Because, like, the number of songs you all seem to know and were able to play is incredible. And I'm particularly struck by the prominence of African-American girl groups in some of the songs you used to cover.
Mm. Yeah, I mean, we were hungry for rock and roll. Anything we could hear from America, and it was, you know, from America, that all the great stuff came. So we kind of studied it, you know, not realizing we were studying it. But we, as you say, we loved so many of the girl groups, you know, the Shirelles and the Chiffons, some of the early girl groups there that we loved. So much so that one of the songs the girl group sang was called Boys, and they were talking about their love of boys. Well, Ringo did it, and he's just boys, talking about boys.
Love that.
And it was like, we didn't care. I don't think any of us thought, whoa, a guy talking about you love boys? It just didn't care. We just loved the music so much. And I say, we kind of studied it because we would look on the record for the composers, and we'd see things like Goffin King. And we think, wow, I wonder who that is. You know, I wonder what they are. And of course, the amazing thing is I was the other night, actually, just a few nights ago, I was at the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame where Carol King, who was the king of Goffin and King, was, you know, inducted into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. So it was that kind of thing. You're just trying to work out how these things happened and what they meant. There was another title. We used to look at the titles, and I think that's why in Beatles songs, titles became very important. We saw a song called Quarter to Three, and we're going, what could that be? Quarter to three? What could it be? And we puzzled us for a long time until we found out it was we dance till a quarter to three. You go, oh, okay. So, you know, that we were very up on what was going on there. And any bit of information I had, John would have, and George would have, and Ringo would have. So it made it easy to communicate. You know, we could just talk about, well, you know, what would Goffin King have done or whatever, you know.
And the Everly Brothers too, and that also affected the way that you sang. The harmonizing was just so incredible.
Yeah, oh, the Everly Brothers. I mean, the truth is, that was us. You know, I was Phil, John was Dom. And we just loved, I still do. And in fact, they were inducted into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame the other night too. About time.
Yeah.
But we just loved them. It was so clear and so pure that if John sang a song, I would naturally just sing the harmony above him. Just because of the Everlys, you know, we love that sound so much.
Is that the choir boy in you as well?
Yeah, there is. There's an aspiring choir boy who got turned down by the Liverpool Cathedral. I had my revenge. I went back with the Liverpool Oratorio. I auditioned there once. The idea was that you could get free school books. Like I wanted school books. But my dad wanted them. Mm. So, you know. But I failed. The guy was at the piano. Just you called in, like, terrified. And he's sitting at the piano, and he just plays some notes. He goes, dung, dung, dung. Please sing those notes. And I go, dung, dung, dung. And he goes, dung, 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 dung. I go, dung, dung, dung. And I've totally failed. I couldn't do it.
You could have harmonized with him, probably, if he'd given you the chance.
Yeah, I could have maybe done that. But I did get in a choir at St. Barnabas Church at Penny Lane, actually. And that was good. I enjoyed it. You know, I enjoyed putting on the cassock and the surplice and the little thing.
May I just ask you about continuity for a moment? I mean, it's extraordinary that the Everly Brothers, have they only just been inducted?
Yeah.
I didn't see the show, but I do know you're talking about looking back to the generations from, you know, the great songwriters who lay behind, to some extent, what you did early on. And you inducted, I think, Dave Grohl, the other?
The Foo Fighters.
And the Foo Fighters. So, I mean, just from that perspective, how do you feel a sense of responsibility to the next generation? I mean, the Foo Fighters have been around for a while, but does this make any sense? Do you?
No, I see what you're saying. I wouldn't call it responsibility. I would just be very happy that we'd inspired them. You know, that's the great thing when you read his book. He's got a book out.
Yeah.
And it's our rival with this book.
Is it? Yeah. I don't know what to say.
No, it's a good book. But, I'm all the way through it. He said, and Paul did it, and Paul did, you know. So that makes me very happy, you know, to think that his generation was inspired by stuff that we did, and now he's carrying it forward. I wouldn't think I would feel responsible for it, but I feel very proud.
Yeah. I want to ask something. George Harrison once said that the Beatles were like forced rhubarb, and that the intensity of those years of Beatlemania made your musical abilities mature weirdly fast. Is that how you see it?
It's true. I am a piece of rhubarb. No. It's really true. You know, that it was very intense. We were a little group in Liverpool, and then we went to Hamburg, and that was a bit of rhubarb growing. And then we came and sort of got on the world stage, and it got really intense. So he's right. We couldn't kind of get out of the garden. You know, we were just forced to grow. Mind you, we enjoyed it most of the time. It got a bit wearing towards the end, but most of the time we were happy. That was what we wanted to do, what we wanted to be, and we wanted to play to everyone in the world. But there was a sense of being under intense pressure at that age, because we were quite young, you know, when all that happened. So he's right, you know. He also said that something about fame played with our. We gave up our nervous systems for it. And I know what he means, you know, because we couldn't just be happy-go-lucky guys down the pub. By now we'd moved beyond that, so we were kind of the Beatles, and it was, you know, there were certain things expected of us, and we had to do certain things in a certain way. And we were always forever trying to break out of it, but there was that element of you've got to do this thing that you're being forced, like rhubarb, to do.
Yeah. But also, think of you as wordsmiths, you know, and the lyric writing, which is often kind of witty as well as beautiful. And I was wondering if it was related to, you know, the kind of quick-witted ways that you all were in news conferences. It still dazzles whenever you see a clip. And I saw an interview it was an interview with all of you when you just got your MBEs. And it was earlier than that. But John was being asked about the Rattle Your Jewellery line from the Royal Varieté performance. And he said that you'd all discussed it the night before. Someone had come up with the line. And it suggested like almost that you were working together, even on the verbal stuff, as a bit of a performance. I thought it was really interesting.
Yeah, you know, I think that's very Liverpool and very Irish. This, you know, I think anyone who goes up to Liverpool and hangs with Liverpool people, there's a lot of humour there. It's just the way we are, you know. And John was very good at it. John, as we all know, you know, he was a very witty guy. So, he came up with that line right before the show. So it was great to have someone like that in the group. I was a little bit more the straight man. You know, I would actually introduce something. Which is probably handy as well. But, you know, he would always have those great lines of, you know, the front row, just rattle your jewelry. So, you know what I think about the Beatles? Okay, so it was Liverpool, first of all, but then it's the combination of those four guys. You know, there were all sorts of other groups around, but the four of us miraculously found each other and were working so intensely that your humor was just part of it. And you kind of knew what the next thing was going to be. He'd say that, I'd say that. So you could work together, and the strength was in the union. So it made it fun, you know, and it helped it to be bearable. But the fact that the four of us, I say, come out of Liverpool with this natural outlook on the world, followed through for the whole of the Beatles thing.
And one other thing I think, Paul Muldoon, you bring up very well in the book is, you know, the way that you all had an ear, and you and John had an ear for a good phrase. So Ringo says a hard day's night, but there's also 8 days a week, which a chauffeur said to you when you were being driven out to John's house. But actually cottoning on to that as the sort of start of a song, I thought was really interesting that you did that.
I think that is very interesting about the Beatles. Looking back over it, this idea of cottoning on to things, as I say, you know, I could have just been, I'd been busted for speeding, so I couldn't drive for a year. I know. So, but anyway, I was heading out to John's house and I had a driver, and I just sort of said to him, how you been going, you know, how you doing? He said, oh, I've been working so hard, we've been working 8 days a week. And then we pulled up at John's place. I said, well, right, I've got the title. You know? So I noticed it, though. I could have just said, oh, yeah, wow, working hard, and left it. But I realized that, you know, what he'd said was special. And this kind of thing happened a lot to us. I'm just thinking back in the recording studio, John had a semi-acoustic guitar, which meant it could be electric as well as acoustic. And he'd just leaned it up against his amplifier while we were going to go and listen to a take with George Martin. And it started feeding back the A string. Oh my God, what's that? I think anyone else would go, oh God, turn the bloody amp off, you know. But it was us like, can we use that? And so George Martin, who was always very alive to all that, he said, yes, I suppose so. And so we used that, and that became the beginning sound on I Feel Fine. Another occasion was when the tape op, who's the assistant to the engineer, put one of the old big tapes we used to work on. He put it on backwards by mistake and played it, and it suddenly, it was like backwards stuff, and we went, yes, what is that? You know, whereas I do think some other people might have gone, oh, come on, Joe, get it right, turn it backwards, you know, and just got on with it. But us, it was like, wow, magical happening, you know, so they all ended up on our records.
So you talked about all the kind of new groundbreaking stuff you're doing, but this is me trying to impress Paul Muldoon. There's a rag and bone shop of the heart element as well to your writing, because you particularly seem very comfortable with the past and nostalgia. I was astounded at how young you were when you wrote When I'm 64. I mean, that was from the Cavern days, wasn't it? What is it about your ability to feel so comfortable with the past from so early on and to almost project into a future past in your songs?
Well, I think it's because up until my mum died, I had a very happy childhood. You know, this family I'm talking about was incredible. You know, I could go on about it for hours, you know. It gets a bit of a yawn after a while. But I had some amazing people in my family, you know. And so just thinking about them and stuff makes me happy. So I'm happy about the past in that way. The actual lyrics to When I'm 64 came later. Right. That was more in my 20s. But the tune I'd written, yeah, on the family piano, aged about 16. So, but the words came later. But again, you know, they play into that working class nostalgia thing that I think is very important. I really think it's very, I mean, if for nothing else, the fact that most people experience that. Most people out of the world know what I'm talking about when you start, you know, reminiscing about your mom and your dad and your uncles and how, oh, Uncle Jack, he was a hoot. You know, there's loads of people who've got the Uncle Jack, you know. Mine was a hoot.
But it wasn't just...
It was great. He had that kind of voice. All right, son. Yeah. Have you heard the one about... And then he'd proceed to tell you, like, a really good joke. And then as he was leaving, he'd say, yeah, come here. And he'd reach in his pocket and he'd get half crowns, which were like, yes. I mean, they were like, I don't know, it's like £5 or £10 now. And he'd just say, yeah, son, you know. And so, you know, you had those people in your life, and so no wonder I'm fond of them.
But there's also, you know, songs, and I know this is one of your favourites, Paul, I want you to tell us why, a song by Eleanor Rigby, which, you know, it is a poem, but it obviously draws in some ways on ideas of memory and ideas of loneliness. Tell us first why it's your favourite, because I think it is your favourite of Paul's lyrics, isn't
it? Well, again, I don't like to choose from them. There are so many great songs, but... It's a song that, first of all, embodies something we were discussing a moment ago, which is the sense of the dramatic, the introduction of a character, then another character, and then bringing them round again. And that notion of the cyclical, you know, which is at the heart of so many art forms, be it music obviously being the main one that we would think of. That's one of the reasons. But one of the realizations I came to through our working together was just how visual the songwriting business might be at its best. And this is another example of it. I mean, we sometimes use the word filmic in these regards, but one is looking at something or someone and looking in a very particular way with a long shot perhaps, and then a close-up. And I think it's the way, in this case, that song combines the visual, the dramatic, for me is really what makes it so great. Yeah. But it's true of other songs too. But I think that's a great example. You use the word poem there. And you know, there are a number of artists in most recent times, Leonard Cohen, say, whose collected poems coincided totally with his collected songs. And I think we're always fascinated when the pressure per square inch, as I call it, of the song is somewhat reminiscent of what we usually associate with the poem. The fact of the matter is that it doesn't necessarily have to stand up by itself on the page. That happens to do so, but you can't quite experience it until you hear the complete package. So in that sense, the lyric is always missing something, and that's the music.
And you mentioned the visual sense. I think you talk in the book about the fact that you see the days of the weeks as colours, which sounded a bit like a form of synesthesia, which I think... quite a lot of musicians have, where your senses overlap and you paint as well. And is that, do you have that sense that you see sounds or you hear colours?
Yeah. you know, I don't know whether other people do this. You know, you're just inside your own little head thinking. And, you know, you think stuff. So one of those things for me, yeah, I always thought of the week in colours. Monday was black. Yes, back to school. Tuesday was yellow. Wednesday's green. Thursday is kind of dark blue, Friday's red, Saturday's orange, and Sunday's white. So I just happen to, you know, think of them like that. I don't know if there's any big significance in it, but yeah, they appear to me like that. And I think these are all the little things that, you know, if you're kind of observant, I think I'm observant. I think I notice stuff. Sometimes, you know, it's kind of awkward. Because, you know, it's a, did you see that? It's like, no, I didn't want you to say that. Yeah, but all these things, it's just stuff that happens naturally inside you. And I don't know, I think everyone does this, but sometimes people say, no, they don't, you know. It's just, but I like all that. Yeah. I like all that stuff.
And you're always sort of sucking up experiences and influences. And I'm fascinated by, you know, when you're living in London in the mid-60s and you've got that amazing attic room in the Asher household, and there's a photograph of it in the book, and I think I'm allowed to compare you to Shakespeare, but there's something of the Garrett view, and you could imagine someone like Shakespeare coming to London and being up in that room writing, and that's where you sat and wrote a lot of your songs. And I don't know if you, and you have the view of the Post Office Tower and everything. It's like London's beneath your feet.
Well, they just wouldn't give me a good room. You're up there. No, it was very generous of them to let me stay in their house, actually. And Jane, who was my girlfriend at the time, her mother, Margaret, was a great woman. So it was very comforting to me. Having lost my mother, so it was great to have a kind of surrogate mother. And yeah, I was lucky. I had this little room at the top, and I managed to get a little piano in there. So it was a bit like that, the rooftops.
You had your gold records under the bed. You didn't have anywhere else to keep them.
I don't know. That's Barry Miles. That may be true. I don't know who said that.
Barry Miles said that.
Yeah, it could be true. I don't know.
It's in your authorized biography, though, yeah. I think it is.
Well, it's true then.
Can I quote something else at you? So I was just thinking, you know, here you are at the Royal Festival Hall, which was part of that whole new age of, you know, kind of culture for everybody. And you were going to the theatre at the National Theatre nearby and concerts and everything. And in fact, Miles says you used to borrow books from the Indica stockroom in the basement and your little slips of paper to say you'd borrowed them because you were reading all this stuff. And one night you went to, I think it was Brian Epstein's house, to meet Joe Orton, the playwright who'd written what could have been the third Beatles film. And he wrote about it in the diary. I don't know if you've read what he wrote about you in his diary. The only thing I get from the theatre, Paul M said, is a sore arse. He said, Lute was the only play he hadn't wanted to leave before the end. I'd have liked a bit more, he said. And I'm fascinated by, I mean, there was someone else who was breaking rules, but also, I mean, that script was quite naughty, so you could see why you didn't make it. But I don't know what you made of the kind of people that you were encountering. You were all breaking the rules of art in their own ways.
Well, I was fascinated. You know, that was one of the great things about the 60s. There was this great coming together of people like Joe. And, you know, if you were, there was a club called The Establishment that
Peter Cook
had. And that was a great melting pot, because you could meet all sorts of people like that, painters and playwrights and various people, novelists and things. And so it was really nice to meet Joe and to know him. I was rung up by someone who said, do you want to be an angel? And you know, I said, the whole thing was fascinating to me. I didn't know what this stuff was. So it was
angel in what?
In the theater. So I said, what do you mean? You know, yes, I'd like to be an angel. But what do you mean? They said, well, you invest in a production.
An angel investor.
Yeah. And that's, so I did. I invested in Lute.
Oh, I see. Mm.
And it was exciting, you know. I mean, I don't know if I made anything off it, but it was just exciting to be an angel in the theatre in London. Yes. You know, it was just an exciting thing to do, you know.
Do you have a sense that that milieu, that mix of painters and poets and songwriters and happens nowadays? Do you think? Do you
I
think
don't it, know, you know. Yeah. I think people all seem to agree that the 60s were very rich that way. I'm sure it does happen, I'm sure, but I don't know. So, but I'd suspect it happens. But, you know, the swinging 60s, as they became known, was great. It was all these people from all over the country that had gravitated towards London and had found places where they could all talk to each other and hang out. And so it was very rich in that way. Or the people you would meet would give you a new perspective on stuff. So I think it kind of, when next time you came to write a song, you'd talk to them on quite a sort of high level about art. So you aspire to that level instead of, you know, you just meeting load of people who just want to talk about
but there's also
something else.
The aspiring side, and you talked about yourself in the book, you talk about your family being posh working class, that there was an unashamed sense of aspiration. And you had that confidence to, like, you know, you'd ring up Bertrand Russell just to meet him. Not a lot of people had the confidence to do that.
Well, I don't know, confidence or cheek, you know. Yeah, you know, like I say, that was the 60s. You would just hear of someone. That old Bertrand Russell's living in Chelsea. I said, oh, yeah, and where? And he'd sort of tell you where he was, so I'd just go along and knock on the door. And I did that quite a lot, you know. I just thought, if I'm really interested in someone, the worst they can do is say, go away, I don't want to talk to you. But often they didn't, you know, so... he was fascinating. There was an American guy who I now suspect was an intern, because I know about that now. I didn't know about that then. It's just an American guy. He said, yeah, wait a minute, you know. And I went into this little room, and there's Bertrand Russell. And we just talked about stuff, philosophy and things. And he started talking about the war in Vietnam, which I hadn't even heard about. Because it wasn't really a British thing, it was an American problem. But he, being a major pacifist, you know, realized that it was a bad war. So he told me about it, and I was fascinated. Again, you know, the fascination of just meeting all these diverse people.
Well, something Paul Muldoon brought up, you know, and you mentioned the Education Act of 1944, so suddenly working class children had the chance to have the same academic opportunities and go to university as, you know, middle class and upper middle class people, and that had never happened before. But also someone talked about the fact that your generation was the first to be educated to a higher level on the whole than your parents, because most people's parents would have left school at 14. And then of course end of national service. In fact, there's a great line about national service not ending. Really, or the war not ending until the Beatles.
Yeah.
Which I thought was lovely.
We basically finished the war. Said, look, Hitler, we're getting born. Piss off. And he did.
You know, I think one has to remember the extraordinary level at which education was conducted in the high school or grammar school. In that era.
But you went to grammar school too,
didn't
you?
I did. But you know, and many of us did. And we had this very similar experiences. But what you were reading was an extremely advanced number of texts that you were exposed to. Yeah. I mean, I'm not absolutely certain if we still have it in the UK education system.
Well,
I'm not sure if we do.
There's a question with that, you know, and it's something I've talked to other people about too, which is, you know, we know loads of libraries have closed around the country in the last decade, and there are those, and I guess I'm one of them, who wonder if, with given your social backgrounds of people like George and Ringo in particular, as well as yours, whether something like the Beatles could happen in this system, in the kind of what we have in terms of the civic structure now, and I wonder what you think. I know you care about education because you set up LEPA.
I don't know, you know, there's so many aspects of what made the Beatles the Beatles. I think that's definitely one of them, because me, John, and George went to grammar schools. So, you know, we did have a good education.
Yeah.
Even though we kind of wrestled against it, we kind of almost didn't want it, but there it was, and so a lot of it went in, you know. Ringo, unfortunately, didn't. God bless him. No, only because he was very seriously ill when he was a kid.
He was. He spent.
He had peritonitis, which is like his mother was told he wouldn't live, you know. But Ringo, he'll outlive us all. Yeah, so he missed a lot of school, and he was quite ill. But the others amongst us, and Ringo caught on and soon was part of, very much equal part of the group. But yeah, we did have a slightly different edge to a lot of the groups that we knew. And we would sometimes play with that, you know, just playfully kind of thing. I remember being in Hamburg, and there was a common dressing room, and we were in there, and Howie Casey and the seniors were in the room too, and Howie's a sax player. And I'd just been sent a book of poetry by my girlfriend in Liverpool. I think it was like Dostoevsky or something. I don't know. I don't know. Probably not. But it was like a Russian name, you know. Anyway, so I got this posh little book of poetry that I was reading. And we saw Howie about to come in, you know. So we all just adopted poses. Like we were really seriously, and I thought, "'Tis of thee, fair woman." And better, you know, whatever. Not sure that's exactly the poem. But, you know, we'd read this, and it was so cute, actually, because Howie comes in, realizes he's in the middle of this very serious poetry reading, and he goes, and he's putting his sax away very carefully so as to not interrupt us. So we always had that little kind of thing, you know, which was just separated us, and it kind of got into music, it got into everything. Yeah. It was just sort of something that part of what made the Beatles special.
Some lovely questions have come in from the audience here at the Royal Festival Hall and from those around the world, so thank you for them. And I'm trying to get through a few now in the time that we have. This is from Jack. Growing up in Ryde on the Isle of Wight, can you talk a little bit about the influence that had on Ticket to Ride when you hitchhiked here with John, and any memories of the trip?
Yeah, was that someone from Ryde?
Is that Jack?
Yeah, my cousin Betty and her husband Mike, Mike and Betty Robbins, were very influential on me. And again, like I say, you know, I would say to John on this occasion, should we go, let's hitchhike somewhere? And he would play along, you know. So we ended up going down to the Isle of Wight Ryde, where they had a pub. They were always running pubs. So they moved around Reading. They were in various places. And we wrote Ticket to Ride there, with the play on Ryde, we spelled R-Y-D-E, and we spelled it. The main memory, though, is just of Betty and Mike. They were so really, you know, lovely people, very funny. She was very musical. He was, kind of, but he was more of a comedian, so that would be his sort of strength. But again, you know, to me, all this stuff seemed so exotic, you know, this, because he was entertainment's manager at Butlins.
Yeah, and there was a Butlins connection.
Come on, that's a good job.
Fabulous.
Well, you wrote to him, didn't you?
Hmm?
There's a letter in the book that you wrote to someone about trying to get work at Butlins.
Yeah, I was trying to get work anywhere. But he was very good. My brother and I, my younger brother, Mike and I, were on a talent competition at Butlins. We were there on holiday, and we entered a talent competition. And like all the other talent competitions, we didn't win. Just as well. But yeah, we sang the Everly Brothers' Bye Bye Love, me and Mike. But no, Betty was very influential, as I say, because her taste in music was more sophisticated than mine. And so she would be playing songs like My Funny Valentine, that I'd never heard that kind of song, but being musical, it was like, wow, what is that? You know. So she opened my eyes to a lot of things. Like, in fact, I did, with the Beatles, I did a song called Till There Was You that was on a little record she had.
So I
discovered a lot of music through her, yeah. So they were down in Ryde, so that was the... But, you know, the kind of little lovely little memories, kind of things that stick out are the silly little things. So this is me and John, and they've only got one guest room, and there's only one bed in it. So me and John have got a top and tail in this bed, so we're lying there, ready to go to bed. And Bette and Mike would come in, the grown-ups. You know, and even though we were kind of, you know, in our late teens, they would kind of tuck us in. And it was great, you know. That's great.
I'm going to get a couple more questions. They're so good. So Tom asks, what is the biggest misconception about being Paul McCartney?
I don't know. Don't know, really. I think the biggest misconception at the end of the Beatles was that I'd broken the Beatles up, and I lived with that for quite a while, saying to people, no, I didn't. But, you know, once the headline's out there, it sticks. And so that was a big one that I only finally just got over. So I would think of that as an old misconception.
I've got another related question. Hang on. George once said... So are we doing it this way to be fair to everyone? Sorry. George once said that although fans, and this is from Neil, George once said that although fans gave their money and their screams, the Beatles gave their nervous systems. I think you mentioned this earlier. Over a 60-year career where you have constantly given so much, what has it cost to be Paul McCartney?
Your privacy. I think that's kind of what you give up. But you have to... I made that decision early on when I could see what was coming with the Beatles. And what had happened was we'd gone on holiday to Greece, and nobody there knew who we were, but we were starting to get a little bit famous back in England. And I used to really listen to the hotel band, which they were really good, just a little quartet, I think. And they played the Greek instrument, you know, the bazooka.
Mm-hmm. Not bazooka.
Bazooka, that's it.
No. Bazooki.
Yeah.
Sorry, so it's my poor enunciation.
But I used to hang out with them anyway. I'd kind of, you know, a bit like a groupie. So so I was talking to them, and I was saying, you know, I'm in a group in England. We're getting quite big, you know. They go, oh, yeah, it's all just sort of spicy, you know. And I couldn't really, you know, persuade them. But I thought, okay, so I've got anonymity here, so I can always come to Greece. That'll be fine. No one will ever know who we are in Greece. Well, that didn't work, because, like, the year after, they knew, you know. So, but to me, I then had to make a decision. So, okay, what are you going to do? You're just getting out of music, or you're going to live with this thing called fame, you know? And I decided I would live with it. And I had to cope with what it brought, you know? And so that's sort of what I'm still doing, coping.
Thank you for coping. I'm going to sneak in a couple more. Because we started a couple of minutes late, I'm going to run over a couple of minutes. Hope that's okay. Otherwise, come on and stop me. This is a lovely question from Uttam. You've always supported issues to do with race, such as the civil rights movement in the 60s, and choosing not to perform to segregated audiences, unlike some of your peers. Where did this sense of social justice come from? Was it from your upbringing in Liverpool as a boy, or when you became a Beatle and travelled?
I think it was Liverpool. Again, you know, I think Liverpool was the first Caribbean community. Mm.
There's a photograph of your mother with another midwife who's obviously of the Windrush generation in the book.
Yeah. So that was like, it was just a given. And nobody thought anything of it, really. You know, a lot of the guys in the groups were black. And it's just, you know, so we didn't really think much of it. We just thought, well, they're mates, you know, and we just thought they were equal, because they were. And when we went to America, there was this time when we were going to play, I think it was Jacksonville or somewhere, and the promoters said, okay, well, get ready, because tomorrow night you're going to be playing in the audience, and the black people will sit over there, and the white people will sit over there. And we went, excuse me? He said, yeah, you know, it's how we do it down here. And we go, oh, no, no. We said, we're not going to do that, you know.
Going to sneak in two last questions before we have to finish. And one of them is, you may have heard that the government announced £2 million for some new Beatles attraction in Liverpool. We're not quite sure what it is. There are those who would wonder, does Liverpool need another Beatles attraction? But also, just the whole issue of, you know what you were up against when you first became famous, and there were those who didn't like getting MBEs, all the rest of it. And now some might say, there are those who might try and co-opt the Beatles into some kind of new sort of patriotic, nationalistic idea of what it is to be British. And I don't know how you feel about either the attraction itself or, you know, where Britain is post-Brexit with its sense of Britishness and the Beatles potentially being co-opted into it.
I mean, you know, obviously, I don't mind because it's great. I know that people from Japan, from America, South America, all know the Beatles. So if they come to Liverpool, that's a lot of what they're coming to see, you know? So I think it's fine. In fact, in the early days of our fame, the Liverpool Council filled in the cavern. You know, so it was the other way at one point. Really like Joni Mitchell's song, To Make a Parking Lot. So I'm quite happy that they're recognizing that it's a tourist attraction. But, you know, I think they could also spend the money on something else.
And my final question is, I know that the poet Adrian Mitchell was a friend of yours, and he famously hated his poems being set in schools and set as exams. And in fact, when the, before GCSEs, the O-level board, they once set one of his poems for O-level. And so to protest, he sat the exam and wrote about it in The Guardian, and he got a C. And I just wondered how you would feel about your lyrics being set for exams and how you think you'd do if you had to analyse them.
The thing is, you know, once you write a song, once I've finished a song, then you kind of release it to the world. So I don't worry what happens to it. And some strange myths happen to these things, you know. But I don't. I think I've come to terms with the fact that not everyone's going to get it, like the meaning that I had. They're going to put their own meanings on it, and I think you have to accept that. I mean, I was on holiday once with, I was on a beach, and there was a little kid, little American girl. She must have been all of 8 years old. And so I was trying to be sort of nice and friendly. She said, oh, you're a Beatle, you know. I said, yeah, yes, I am. And trying to be, you know, friendly. And she said, I've just been learning about you in school. I said, oh, really? And I said, what was it? And she told me a story that wasn't true. It was one of the kind of, you know, like conspiracy theories. And I said, well, no, let me put you straight. I said, you're up. I'm one of the Beatles. I was there. Now, that's not true. What really happened was, and she said, no. I learned it in school. So, okay. So you kind of have to let it go, you know. It's just good that they even are talking about it or listening.
You just have to let it be.
Huh? You have to let it be. Or amen.
Amen.
Amen. Final thought from you, Paul Muldoon, because it's thanks to you that you've got Paul to talk and be able to put it all into a book.
Well, it's thanks partly to me, but actually I should say, you know, it's thanks largely to the editors involved, initially Bob Weil, who was involved, and then Stuart at Penguin, and the great team there, and the great team at working with Paul McCartney. They all had a huge input into this, and I think it's a collective achievement.
Right. And sounds like an Oscar speech.
You know, I can't tell you. There must be some openings in this part of the world, and I'm happy to stand for them. Now, joking apart, this is a collective effort, and it was really wonderful. It was a pleasure to be able to do this, and a thrill to be able to celebrate
share
here
with everyone in the room. Well, can I just say to the audience who've been fantastic, what wonderful questions, and the audience on the live stream around the world, I think we can all agree that having a chance to be in a room with Sir Paul McCartney and talk about his lyrics and the joy he's given us. It's been a great honour. Thank you.